Welcome to Learn the Sky, your online resource for learning about the constellations and how to find them. If you're new to this channel, be sure to click the subscribe button and hit the bell for notifications about new videos. Learn the Sky is also on Patreon, so if you'd like to support this channel, the link is listed below. And finally, if you would like to study the sky in greater detail and need a guide, visit learnthesky.com to learn more about our online classes we offer. Welcome, my name is Janine, and in this video we will learn about the constellation known as Draco. Draco is represented as a dragon, and it's an ancient constellation. The ancient Babylonians, Chinese, Greek, and Roman cultures all identified Draco. The name Draco is Latin for dragon, and it was recorded as one of Ptolemy's 48 constellations in the 2nd century, which was the authority in the field of astronomy for many centuries. Draco is known for its star called Thuban, and this was the star that was once the pole star between 3942 BC and 1793 BC. So when can you find it, and how can you find it? It's a constellation that can be seen all year round in the Northern Hemisphere, which classifies it as a circumpolar constellation. The way I find it is to look for the Big and Little Dippers, and then I know that the tail of the dragon goes in between the two dippers. This can be a difficult constellation to find because the size of it is, it's just a really large constellation, and then the magnitude of the stars are fairly faint. There's only three stars that are above the third magnitude, so the rest of them are 4, 5, and 6. So you really want to seek out dark skies when you're trying to find this constellation. I also look for this quadrilateral shaped head as well, and I'll give you some different strategies throughout this video on how to find Draco. Now let's review the pattern that Draco makes across the sky. Here we have the official star map of Draco, and you can see all the constellations that surround it, including Ursa Minor, Ursa Major, Cepheus, here's Hercules down here, and Botes, Lyra, Cygnus, a lot of constellations that are really easy to identify. But what I want you to notice is the magnitude scale down here. So 0 would be the brightest magnitude, like the star Lyra, or the star Vega that's in the constellation Lyra. But most of the other stars of Draco are pretty faint. They're of 4th magnitude and dimmer. So this makes it a challenging constellation to find. But if we zoom in here, the way to really find Ursa Major or Draco is to look for Ursa Major and Ursa Minor. That's how I find it. The tail goes between those two constellations, and then I look for this four-sided shape in the sky. So let's get some practice trying to find this constellation. First, you may notice the three brightest stars towards the left side of the photograph. This is the handle of the Big Dipper, okay? And then here are two of the brighter stars in Ursa Minor. So if you can figure out where Ursa Minor and Ursa Major is, know that the tail goes in between. So if we trace it through here, that's where Draco is. And here's that quadrilateral shaped head of Draco. So there's where Draco is. And here's where other constellations are situated. So we have Ursa Major, Ursa Minor. We're not seeing Polaris here, which is the North Star, and then Cepheus is right there. Here's another photograph. This one's zoomed out a little bit more, so you should be able to find the Big Dipper, which is an asterism. It's a smaller pattern within a larger constellation, which is part of Ursa Major, and then hopefully you can find Ursa Minor. So if we were to point out, here's Ursa Minor, here's the North Star, and here's the Big Dipper. Now from there, you want to find the tail in between the two, and then you can trace out Draco. So what would this look like? Here's the Big Dipper. The pointer stars point to Polaris, and from there you can find Ursa Major. And then here is Draco, how it goes in between the two. And another way that I help myself to find Draco is when you have the handle of the Big Dipper, you can kind of draw a line this way and it'll point to the head. So that's another strategy you can use to find Draco. Let's get some more practice with identifying Draco. So here we have another photograph of the same three constellations. We have Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, and Draco. So hopefully you can see Ursa Major on the left side, and then use the pointer stars to point to Polaris, and there you can find Ursa Minor. From there, You want to find the tail of Draco, and what you should notice if we back up a little bit, notice how these stars stand out, but the tail of Draco is really faint. It's really the head of the dragon that stands out when you compare it to the rest of the stars in the constellation. Okay, also remember you can use the handle of the Big Dipper, draw a line over, and then you can help yourself find the head of Draco. So here we have these two constellations, and then this is where Draco is. Let's get one more photograph here. This one, I believe, is digitally enhanced. The stars are colored to bring out the stars, and that's okay for me when you're starting to learn these constellations. If that will help you learn the different patterns, I think that's fine, but just know that the constellation won't really look like this in the sky. So hopefully looking at this pattern and this picture, you can find Ursa Major, and then from there, can you find Draco? This time you don't have the help of Ursa Major or the Big Dipper to help you. So if we were to point out those constellations, this is that winding shape that Draco takes in the sky with that four-sided head, and then here we have Ursa Minor. Finally, we'll take a look at the celestial objects that sit in the constellation of Draco. So there aren't a whole lot of celestial objects, even though this is a fairly large constellation, but the two we'll focus on are these two. This one is called the Cat's Eye Nebula, which is a planetary nebula that's estimated to be 3,000 light years away, and then M102, which is one of the Messier objects that's a spiral galaxy. So the Cat's Eye Nebula is a planetary nebula, which is a star that's at the end of its life. It's no longer undergoing fusion, so it's starting to throw out the outer layers, and you kind of can see the different layers here. Inside here is a white dwarf star, which will eventually become the leftover core of the star that used to be. It's estimated to be 3,000 light years away, and it is such a beautiful object. You would need to see magnification in order to see it, and then this photo, of course, is a long exposure photograph, which allows us to see the different layers and features of this nebula. Next, we have Messier 102, and this is sometimes called the Spindle Galaxy, and this is an S0 spiral galaxy, estimated to be 44 million light years away. If you're going to look for it, it's in this region of Draco. So it's not as large as our Milky Way galaxy. It's estimated to only be two-thirds the diameter, but the mass is very similar. So this picture taken by the Hubble is just a beautiful shot of the edge-on spiral galaxy that we can see. This kind of has this dark dust lane in which light is not able to penetrate through. There's one other interesting galaxy I'd like to point out to you called the Tadpole Galaxy, and this is called a disrupted barred spiral galaxy, and you're not likely to see this one even with magnification. This is taken by the Hubble, and it's estimated to be 420 million light years away, so it's really, really far. And you can see how it got its name, the Tadpole Galaxy. It kind of has this head with a long tail. So what's interesting here is there's some sort of merger that happened here in terms of galaxies, and this is the shape that it has. So very interesting to see. Let's examine some of the legends behind Draco. It is often the stories of the stars that we can connect to in some way, which can help us remember the constellation. But remember, there are as many mythologies and constellations as there are stars in the sky, so there is no one correct mythology. One of the earliest stories of Draco can be traced back to the ancient Babylonian mythologies. Tiamat was a primordial goddess of the salt sea and the symbol of creation. She's often depicted as a woman, and it is said that she gave birth to a host of creatures that lived in the primordial sea, including scorpion men and merpeople. There's some debate as to whether Tiamat takes the form of a sea serpent or dragon. In Greek mythology, there are a wide range of stories that include a dragon. One is that of the Garden of Hesperides. This was Hera's orchard, and it had a tree that produced golden apples, and it would grant immortality to whoever ate the apples. The trees were given by the goddess Gaia to Hera and Zeus for a wedding gift. And Hesperides were nymphs of the evening and golden light of sunset, and they were given the tasks of tending to the grove, but occasionally they picked the apples themselves. So Hera didn't trust the nymphs, and she placed a dragon around the tree for additional protection. And here you can see the dragon is all around the nymphs. Another famous Greek legend is that of the 12 labors of Hercules. For one of the tasks, Hercules, or in Greek mythology he was Heracles, and then it was adapted as Hercules in Roman mythology, Heracles needed to steal a golden apple from Hera's garden, and he killed the dragon that was protecting the apples. You can see here's the apple tree, and here is the dragon that's protecting the tree. And Hercules is in fact situated next to Draco in the sky. Another tale in Greek mythology is that of Cadmus, who is the king and founder of Thebes. In this tale, Cadmus slayed a dragon that killed some of his men as they were looking for sources of water. And one final tale includes a dragon is that of Jason and the Argonauts in the search for the Golden Fleece, and you can see that in this image here. This artwork depicts Jason being regurgitated by the serpent that guards the Golden Fleece, and this is Athena right here that stands right next to him. So there are a variety of legends about Draco in the sky, and without a doubt, there are many, many other stories that exist out there. It's easy to see why Draco's pattern by many ancient constellations saw a snake, a sea serpent, or a dragon that winds its way around the sky. Remember that the mythologies of the stars vary according to time, place, and culture. There is no one true mythology for any constellation, just a variety of them. We've come to the end of our video about Draco, so let's review everything we learned so far. It's best seen all year round in the Northern Hemisphere, and it's classified as a circumpolar constellation since we can see it all year round. It circles around the pole star. The best way to find it is to use Ursa Major and Ursa Minor. The tail of Draco is in between the two. There are a few celestial objects, such as the Cat's Eye Nebula, there's a couple galaxies, but you would need magnification to see all of them. So this is a constellation that has taken me years to find, or at least get comfortable finding it, but now that I know that the tail is in between the two dippers, I'm able to find it. I definitely recommend that you seek out dark skies when trying to find this constellation, since so many of the stars are dim. So I wish you luck finding Draco. Remember, practice makes perfect. Keep going outside and keep looking up.